Hello and welcome to Alliance for Democracy's The Populist Dialogues. My name is David Delk and I am your host. Today our guest is Bob Bessel. He is an associate professor of history and director of the Labor Education and Research Center at the University of Oregon. Welcome to the show, Bob.
Thanks for having me.
Good. Thank you for being here. So we want to talk about labor in general today, which is a huge topic. Let's start with what the purpose of the Labor Education and Research Center is.
Sure. We've been around since 1978. We're a program that provides teaching, research, and technical assistance to largely to labor unions, but also to a variety of constituencies that are involved with issues related to work and employment. So there are about 30 to 35 of these types of programs around the country. They really stem from a time when the union movement was particularly strong, and it said if you provide these sorts of programs for agriculture, cooperative extension, forestry, business, that working men and women should be able to get resources from the university to do their jobs more effectively.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, very good. Yeah. It seems like there's a real need for that, and without these kind of programs, then the support that unions need to exist, at least in part, dissipates.
Well, I think it's very interesting. Historically, there was a real sense, particularly when the industrial unions came into power in the 1930s and 40s, that in many of those states, the Wisconsins, the Pennsylvanias, the Ohios, the New Jerseys, the union movement said, we want to make this system work. We have a new system of industrial relations, new relations between workers and their employers. Workers not only want to be industrial citizens in the workplace, they want to be citizens in the political and civic realm as well. And they really wanted all kinds of instruction and training on how to make that work. Mm-hmm. So that's really the impetus and origin for university-based, college-based workers' education programs.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, great. And so most of the work you do is used by labor unions to support their organizing? Is that in general?
It's a broad purview, so we do work that that helps in terms of the collective bargaining grievance handling representation process. We do research on issues that are related to work and employment as far as quality jobs. We research on conflict resolution and communication, and certainly around organizing both in terms of members internally as well as trying to recruit new people into unions. Okay. So it's a it's a pretty wide set of entertaining and interesting set of things that we get to do.
Great, yeah. And are there centers like this through most of the states?
Yes, there are. The West Coast centers, we do have sister programs in Washington State and in California. Most of them are located, perhaps not surprisingly, in areas of union concentration, such as the Northeast, the Midwest, and to a much lesser degree in the South.
Oh, right. Okay, right, yeah. Because, of course, the South has historically been pretty anti-union.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah. That's right.
Okay, right. Yeah, so are union rights and a right to form a union, is that a civil right that we as Americans have?
Is it a right that we as Americans have? Well, it's a right that we have in theory. I think, in fact, we actually have it much less because historically, in a country that has prided itself so much on the free market, free enterprise, and the sort of unfettered type of free market capitalism, unions have always had to exist in a hostile environment. So when the right to organize first became enshrined in federal labor law, what was the Wagner Act, the National Labor Relations Act in 1935, which was called the Magna Carta of labor, and said you have that right to organize. Many other countries in Western Europe and elsewhere had those rights well before we did. We were relatively late to getting those rights. Now, the Wagner Act has been amended twice since 1935, in 1947 and 1959, and in both cases, workers' rights were largely narrowed. So it's interesting, we've had that act now for over 70 years, and there's really been not that much done to try to improve upon it or to find, well, not to fine-tune it, to really make it an effective guarantor of workers' rights to organize. And I would simply say, based on my own experience as an organizer for 10 years working for a union and the research I've done and things I know since, that really the right of workers to organize in the private sector in America is virtually a joke. It really, truly is Dave, an act of courage for a private sector worker to say that he or she wants to organize a union, because employers have taken advantage of the loopholes in the law, the limits of the penalties and those sorts of things to make it very, very difficult for workers to organize unions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. And so you said 1949, that was the Taft-Hartley Act?
47.
47?
47 Taft-Hartley. Was Taft-Hartley, right.
Okay, and then in 59?
That was the Landrum-Griffin Act.
Okay, and I'm not familiar. What did that do?
Landrum-Griffin began to narrow ways in which workers could act collectively. Taft-Hartley had taken care of things called secondary boycotts, where workers who weren't directly involved in an immediate dispute could support in sympathy and solidarity those workers who were out. And that Landrum-Griffin further narrowed those sorts of possibilities. Landrum-Griffin also did, a lot of it was in reaction to the McClellan Committee hearings in the late 50s and the focus on Jimmy Hoffa and the Teamsters. Mm-hmm. And there were things done to grant workers broader individual rights within their unions as far as elections and reporting and transparency. So there were some things in there that I think you could view as being positive. But by and large, both of these acts were really designed at trying to curb union power in an explicit way.
Okay. All right. What kind of acts would Congress need to pass now to help empower unions?
Well, there was one that the union movement really, well, there's been several attempts to reform labor law, to provide stronger penalties, to make sure that elections occurred more quickly. Because generally what happens is employers have a long time from the time that workers begin to start to organize and talk about having a union to put it frankly, to scare the hell out of people, yeah. To threaten to close plants. I tried to organize and organized a lot of places. The only time I ever heard in the private sector an employer who didn't make a threat to close the facility or the factory or the place we were trying to organize was a bank.
Oh, really? Uh-huh.
Because it was pretty hard to say we're going to close the bank.
Right.
But everything else, textile factories, plastics factories, chemical factories that we were trying to organize, they always made that sort of threat. Mm-hmm. So you need meaningful penalties if employers, which they often do, fire people illegally or harass or intimidate them. You need quicker elections. There was an attempt to do that in 1978. It fell 3 votes short. Mm-hmm. This was under Jimmy Carter of breaking a filibuster. The Employee Free Choice Act, which came in the early 2000s, did pass the House of Representatives. There was great hope in union circles that President Obama would be able to bring it to the floor and pass it. And it never got to the floor, and particularly after the mid-year elections in 2010.
Yeah.
And there was not a filibuster-proof majority in either House to do it. Mm-hmm. So unfortunately, from my perspective, that legislation, which would have really helped enhance workers' right to organize, is now pretty much a dead letter.
Mm-hmm. At least, and do you think that this coming election might change the atmosphere in Congress?
Well, I'd certainly I'd certainly hope so. But of course, that 60-vote barrier in the Senate is just really enormous. Mm-hmm. Because again, this got through the House the last time. I mean, I think that most people in the Democratic Party, certainly, and a small coterie of Republicans support this legislation. But let me just, this figure highlights just how much things have changed. During the cloture vote in 1978, there were 14 Republicans, 14 who voted for cloture. Hmm. There has not been one Republican in the Senate. Arlen Specter, when he was a Republican, signed on to this, but there hasn't been one Republican in the U.S. Senate that was for this legislation. So there's been this huge political shift in the country to the right, and in terms of labor rights, again, it's pretty hard to put together a bipartisan coalition
yeah.
to make this kind of legislation happen.
Uh-huh. Right.
So it's hard in the short term to be optimistic. I think that, on the other hand, I suspect these things will be talked about in the campaign, because most of the Republican candidates have made it clear that they don't have much love for the union movement. They favor right-to-work legislation,
right.
and I think would adamantly oppose any type of legislation to expand or reinforce workers' rights mm-hmm. to organize.
Right, yeah. So right-to-work laws, let me just explain to our audience, because I'll bet there are a lot of non-union people out there who don't really know what a right-to-work law is.
Mm. Well, right-to-work really comes, and it is actually a misnomer. It's not really about anyone's right to work, but it really is about whether one should be required to join a union as a condition of employment. So Taft-Hartley in 1947, I think the feeling was of anti-union forces that, well, if we can make this more open to folks, whether they have to join a union or not, we can weaken unions. And I think that certainly has happened. So mm-hmm. it's possible in states that allow it, you know, to have in, you know, in Oregon is one, it's a union shop state. So you say that once you, after 30 days or 60 days, whatever your union contract provides for, at that point, people have to join the union because, and pay dues because the other thing is that unions, whether you're in the union or not, in a right-to-work state, they have to represent you. Mm-hmm. So say you're not in the union, Dave, and you come to me as the union rep and say, I'm not in the union, but, you know, I got a grievance or I got a problem, or, you know, you're negotiating a contract on my behalf and improving my wages and benefits, but I don't have to pay you mm-hmm. for that. Oh, right. So there's this notion of free riders, and that's something that really sticks in the craw of most people in the union movement, that there were votes, majority votes, that established unions. So at that point, that's what workers decided, but in the right-to-work states, you're allowed to opt out. You can say, at given period, you don't want to pay union dues, yet the union has what is called in the law a duty of fair representation. They have to represent you. Most of the right-to-work states, perhaps not surprisingly, are in the South, parts of the Midwest, the Southwest. They tried to get it done in New Hampshire and didn't succeed. They're on the verge, it appears, of getting it done in Indiana. And most of those states, the percentage of unionism, you'd have to put it under a microscope to find it. Wow. So it's clearly been an effort to weaken the union because you just drain its treasury or make it very difficult for unions to have the resources that they need to represent people.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So there's been a big change in who is represented, who is a member of a union for the past 40 years. Can you just describe that change from, you know, maybe from the time that Reagan got into office and moving forward?
Yeah, even going back a little bit before Reagan, I think one of the great untold stories, really, of the union movement and things that have happened as far as worker rights and worker representation is that there's been large numbers of people in the public sector, state, county, municipal government, who have become union members. That's really, I think, a great and still understudied story. So what you've had is when the 1950s, 30 upwards, almost 40% of many workers in the private sector were members of unions. Now, a lot of those jobs have gone offshore. There's jobs that have been technologically eliminated, and it's harder. And it's also been hard, as I mentioned before, to organize in those sectors. The public sector's generally been a more user-friendly environment as far as workers organizing. And again, many of those are jobs you can't outsource.
Right.
You can't bring teachers in from Malaysia or China, you know, or send that work to Malaysia or China and have it done. Mm-hmm. So if you look at the percentages, the public sector has been pretty steady at anywhere from about 36, 37, 38% of the workforce. Public sector workers are organized. The private sector, according to the last Bureau of Labor Statistics, and we'll get the new ones for 2011 at the end of next week, that's down to, I believe, 6.9%. So there's been a huge shift in terms of private sector and public sector union membership.
And that private sector percentage, what was that like when Reagan came into office?
When Reagan came in, it was probably still in the high 20s, I would say. And again, I think we can both undervalue and overrate the firing of the air traffic controllers in 1981. Uh-huh. But let me—we just passed, commemorated, or observed. I hesitate to say celebrate. Right. I won't say celebrate the anniversary of that. Mm-hmm. But I think one of the things there were trends that were already well underway when Reagan came into office. And I think what happened, though, interestingly enough, although this was a public sector federal workers strike, that the effects were even far more profound in the private sector, because right after that, you know, that's another big change, is the right to strike. The workers used to have a right to strike and they were pretty comfortable exercising it. Mm-hmm. And you can just apart from PATCO that we used to have, they keep the statistics by 1,000 of workers number of strikes. That used to be 200, 300, always in triple digits up until 81, and it's plummeted after that. I think in the last few years, those types of strikes have numbered less than 20, or even in many cases less than 15 in many of those years. So without that right to strike and collective bargaining, it became very difficult for workers, and so you had a round in the 80s of what was called concession bargaining. And first there were strikes that were crushed and defeated, and employers bought in who they didn't think they well, they had the right to bring in, I'd call them scabs, they call it, the nicer term is permanent replacement, that they used to feel constrained in terms of doing that, even though they had the legal right to do so. Mm-hmm. And so workers, so employers started doing that, and you began to have concessions as far as health care benefits, pension benefits. Bargaining used to be that each time out, you'd put a brick, or sometimes in good times, two or three, on the edifice you were building to protect workers and provide them more security, and the bricks started getting stripped away in the 80s and beyond. I think that's really one of the lasting legacies of the air traffic controller strike and what Reagan did there. It's interesting, I have a friend and colleague who's just written a really wonderful book, A History of the PATCO Strike, and one of the things he points out is that Reagan actually wasn't against public sector collective bargaining, but he did oppose this illegal strike, whereas the Republicans and the right nowadays, they want to go after public sector collective bargaining particularly, and that's what happened in Wisconsin, Ohio, and elsewhere. Right. So it's ironic because Reagan is kind of the patron saint of many people on the right, but even Reagan, who you know actually was a union president, president of the Screen Actors Guild, mm-hmm. while he was not particularly pro-union, he did not want to go after collective bargaining as collective bargaining. Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Okay. All right. That's interesting. So conservatives have portrayed union members as the new privileged class.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
How do you feel about that? Are they?
Well, I think what's happened, and that's a term generally, actually Mitch Daniels, the governor of Indiana, has used that term in terms of describing public sector workers versus private sector workers. First, I think you have to do apples-to-apples comparisons, and I think when you do that in terms of the types of work that workers do in the public and private sector, most of, I think, the reputable studies I've seen suggest that public sector workers actually might be underpaid, although some their benefits, their pensions sometimes are better. But, you know, this thing Newt Gingrich did recently where he's saying that custodians in New York City earn more than teachers, when it was fact-checked, it turned out that he was taking the most skilled types of maintenance folks and using their salary as the standard mm-hmm. rather than somebody at an entry level for, custodial land for teaching. So there's lots of funny stuff that people do.
This is exactly why we need programs like yours to be able to point these kinds of things out.
Yeah, right? And in addition to that, I think the other thing that's really happened is that for people in the private sector, that number now that it's below 7% represented, this wasn't such an issue when there were 30% of the people in the private sector were union members and the public sector was organizing. I mean, these folks didn't mind their taxes going to pay for those salaries. Mm-hmm. We all did better when we all did better, as Paul Wellstone used to say. But now if you're a private sector worker, you don't have a union, do you have sick days? Do you have vacation days? What's your health care look like? Do you have a pension? Well, maybe a 401k, and yeah. we know mm-hmm. that can be very iffy. And so those workers are really hurting. I think they're angry, and there is a tendency to be resentful. And unfortunately, I think the tendency is to say the public sector, which is doing relatively better because they have strong unions, let's drag you down to my level, rather than I think the better approach would be to say, raise me up to your level. Right. So if I have rights and I can bargain and negotiate, we know for a fact that I will do better. So I think that's the dynamic that's at work. And there are clearly political forces that want to pit public sector and private sector workers against each other and reap political advantage from that. And that's what you really saw in Wisconsin, Ohio, and other states where mostly Republican governors went after collective bargaining rights, not just concessions, say where it's a hard time and we need concessions, but we can't afford, literally they were saying, we can't afford you having the right to bargain collectively. Mm-hmm. That's what Scott Walker said, John Kasich said in Ohio, and others.
Mm-hmm. But the reason, at least part, in my view, at least part of the reason why they're talking about union members being a privileged elite now is that it diverts attention from the real source of the economic problems we're having now, which was the wealthy 1% that cooked the system to their advantage.
Yeah, I agree. I think there's a real elaborate bait and switch here that the reason our economy's in the ditch or the toilet, whichever place you want to put it, was because of these greedy public sector employees. It had nothing to do or very little to do with the shenanigans and chicanery on Wall Street. Mm-hmm. So yes, I think that's exactly part of the political calculus mm-hmm. here.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So you brought up Governor Walker in Wisconsin and the other states. And of course, when he made that proposal, union certainly reacted quite strongly. Tell us a little bit about that reaction and where it stands now.
Yeah, I think that was the extraordinary thing, Dave, and I've got some colleagues in Wisconsin who I've talked to about this, and I think one of the things that Walker felt was that, and others, that they were riding this wave of anti-public employee sentiment. And the thing that Walker did in Wisconsin was he cut a deal with the police and firefighters that he wasn't going to take their bargaining rights away, and I think he felt, I'm driving a wedge here, and I have these really reputable sorts of people who will be on my side. What he didn't count on was that police and firefighters said, no, this is wrong that you're taking the bargaining rights away from other folks. And what people in Wisconsin were telling me was that there was just, it was leaderless. It was a spontaneous uprising from below of all these people that just said, you know, it's one thing to ask for concessions in hard time. It's another thing to go after our fundamental right to collectively bargain. So it was extraordinary when you saw 60,000 people, you know, out in the Capitol in Wisconsin, those people in the rotunda sleeping and camping, Democratic legislators who went across the border into Illinois, the level of outrage and resistance, and not just the usual suspects. I mean, there were farmers, there were teachers, there were people, many people who hadn't even done anything like this politically in their life, or if not in their life recently. Mm-hmm. And I think that the polling and everything that came out after that suggested that Americans might have some issues in terms of the role of government and in terms of public employees, but to take away a fundamental right to bargain about the wages, hours, and working conditions that you have on the job, people weren't prepared to go there. Mm-hmm. And now you've seen, you know, the recalls of some legislators in Wisconsin. Scott Walker, there's enough votes to recall him as governor, and they overturned the draconian legislation in Ohio that took away collective bargaining by a public referendum. Mm-hmm. So there's been a very interesting and, I think, powerful response to that. And, of course, I think Occupy Wall Street is echoing some of those sentiments as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Speaking of Occupy Wall Street, what relationship has labor had, or how does labor feel about Occupy Wall Street?
That's an interesting question, and I think it's still playing out. But I think one of the things was that the union movement had been trying to make many of the points that Occupy has made as far as changing the narrative or the message about what was wrong and what was going on in our political culture and our economy. So I think there was a tremendous sense of excitement that this spontaneous movement was able to really, if it hasn't done anything else, and I think it's done a lot of things, but it certainly has helped to shift the public and social narrative. Mm-hmm. So I think the union movement was trying to figure out a way to work with Occupy. So in lots of parts of the country, there was certainly financial support, logistical and material support. There were union people that were involved in this. But I think also there was a sense that the union movement sometimes has a tendency to want to be in the forefront and take over movements. Mm-hmm. So that's been the negotiation, I think, that's gone on, how to work with this movement and to work with it effectively, but not to appear as if the union movement wants to take it over. The other thing is, I think Occupy is anti-political, or at least in the sense that I think it doesn't have much faith in electoral politics, mm-hmm. given Citizens United and the flow of corporate money. The union movement has similar qualms, but it's very much a political animal. So there's going to be some differences to navigate in the coming months, especially since we're in a campaign season, and how mm-hmm. both of those movements relate to that. But I think there has been a pretty good working relationship across the country in many, many places between the union movement and Occupy.
Okay, good, good. I think that one of the real values of the Occupy movement is that it's not aligning itself specifically with a party. You know, an existing party is maintaining its ability to pressure where it sees a real need. So I think it's really good that unions have been supportive, but not trying to dominate the process.
Right. And I can say that I know there's been a lot of discussion about that, a lot of thought that went into that stance. And again, I think there really is a working relationship that hopefully will evolve, I think, in positive and useful directions in the future.
Mm-hmm. Great. Yeah. We've got about 2 minutes. I want to ask you one more question. So, what benefits specifically do workers get by being unionized?
Well, fundamentally, they get a voice. Fundamentally, they have a voice, whereas without a union, they really don't I think, always have an effective one. When you strictly have to rely on, you know, you read all these self-help books, what do you do when you want to raise and go into the boss and how do you present yourself and all of that? Well, they can just say no. Or, you know, most private sector workers are at-will employees. Mm-hmm. That, you know, when, you know, that you can be fired for almost anything. And, you know, at-will, I always say, it's not at your will, it's at theirs. Yep. So you have an effective voice. And then when you can bargain, you can bargain about the basic conditions that govern your life on the job. So there's a very powerful democratic element to that. The other thing that I think I should just mention very quickly, and we think about new developments, workers who didn't have very much respect in recent years have organized: childcare workers, home health care workers, workers who care for the disabled, adult foster care. I've taught those people. I've seen with my own eyes. Not only have they gotten wages and benefits, workers' compensation, and these folks were often treated, you know, not very well, even though they cared for our most vulnerable populations. Mm-hmm. What I've seen is they've gotten a voice. And these are people who now can go to the legislature in Salem and speak with confidence and with power. And so, as they used to say, and I think it is still very much true, that industrial democracy means not only democracy on the job, it means effective democratic and civic participation as a citizen. So I could go on, of course, but those are some of the things I think that are most powerful that people get from the union movement. Okay. And it, you know, has to do with essential, fundamental human dignity and functional exercise of citizenship. Right.
Okay. And those same benefits are then a benefit to society in general. I mean, it's not just a benefit only to the people who actually become union members. It's much more generalized.
Well, you think back to the New Deal, one of the rationales for labor legislation was to increase the purchasing power of workers. And to me, I think we need to be talking more about how do we have a high wage, high productivity, high road economy. So workers earn more money, they spend that money, it helps small businesses, it helps the community. It has a multiplier ripple effect rather than this other metaphor, unfortunately, that we're using too often, the race to the bottom.
Right. Okay. Good. Thank you very much for being here, Bob.
Thank you, Dave. My pleasure.
Okay. Great. Good. So that concludes our program today. You need to, if you want to learn more about the Labor Education and Research Center at the University of Oregon, go to the website, which is on your screen now, pages.uoregon.edu/LERC/. In terms of upcoming events, we have Jeff Clemens, who is an author and an attorney. His new book is called Corporations Are Not People, Why They Have More Rights Than You Do and What You Can Do About It. The Alliance for Democracy has invited Jeff Clements to come to Portland on Saturday, February 11th from 7 until 9 p.m. at the First Unitarian Church here in Portland, Oregon, Southwest 12th and Salmon. Jeff Clemens reveals the far-reaching effects of the strange and destructive idea that corporations have human free speech rights because they are people. Such ideas fly in the face of not only all common sense, but most American legal history as well. Most importantly, he offers solutions and tools to help readers join a grassroots movement for democracy. And we will be interviewing him here on our Populist Dialogue program, and that will air on February 19th. So we want to thank our crew today for being here. Without them, we wouldn't be on the air. So thank you to Tom Thomas, Joan Horton, Roger Bates, Dave King, and Janet Morris. And thank you to the audience for watching. We hope that you'll be watching again next week. Bye.